Welcome to Buried Secrets, a podcast about the paranormal, the occult, and weird and forgotten history. I'm Chris. This week, I'm continuing my deep dive into hidden cemeteries in Astoria and neighborhoods near Astoria. And I'm excited to look at a cemetery and homestead that dates back to before the Revolutionary War. It's the oldest residence in New York City that has been continuously used as a residence. And I checked it out for the first time this weekend. So I'm excited to talk about what I saw when I visited, but most importantly, the history of this home and this cemetery and sort of the sweet love story behind the current owner and how she came to live in this home next to this old cemetery. But before we get to that, a little bit of housekeeping. So the first thing is, at least for the next little while, I think I'm going to switch the episode dropping schedule for a little bit. I've been dropping episodes every Friday for the last almost a year, except for in December. And I think I need to switch to every other Friday because I'm finding that I'm just not really giving myself enough time to do the amount of research that I want to be doing. So I'm going to switch to that release schedule. I'm sorry to be giving you fewer episodes less often, but I hope that the quality will improve because I keep ending up in this place where I run out of time for my research. So I either have to cut an episode in half and do it as a multi-part, which that might happen anyway for some topics. Some topics are just too big to cover in one episode. But there have definitely been some episodes where I really wanted to go into more depth or to not necessarily divide something up, but I just couldn't do that because it's just me doing all the research and editing and everything for this. So I don't know that this is going to be a permanent change, but at least for a little while, I got to switch to every other week. Also, you might see this week, I didn't do a cold open. Let me know if you guys like that or not. I thought it might be nice to get right into the body of the episode, but if anybody really misses the cold open, let me know. Just playing around with that format a little bit. And before we get into today's topic, I wanted to talk about what I'm reading. So I, to be honest, haven't been reading that much lately. Work has been really hectic and has cut into my reading and research time, for sure. But I was super excited this week to get my copies of The Feminine Macabre, which is that new journal highlighting the work of women in the paranormal. And I mentioned it a couple weeks ago because I have an essay in it about the Hellgate and its ghosts and its legends and history. And I've been flipping through the journal and sort of reading things at random as things catch my eye. I'm so excited to have read it cover to cover, but probably I'm going to do that by skipping around. And as I was flipping through, I found a really fun article or essay, I guess, about the ghost of Tony Jo Henry. It's written by Jennifer Jones. And this caught my eye because it's about a haunting in Lake Charles, Louisiana, which is where my granny and gramps live and some of my extended family lives. And while I've never lived in Louisiana, I am Cajun and I've spent a lot of time in Lake Charles. And I had never heard this story about this female murderer who was the first woman executed using the electric chair in all of Louisiana. And she was only the second woman executed in the state's history up to that point. And she was jailed at the Calcasieu Parish Jail, and she was tried at the Calcasieu Parish Courthouse. And in the intervening years, there have been stories of hauntings at the Calcasieu Parish Courthouse. So I was really excited to see this story. It was a really interesting essay. And to be honest, when I was flipping through this journal, I just couldn't believe all the cool topics that it covers. So I'll probably continue talking about some of the awesome things I've been reading in this as I read them. So I'll keep you guys posted there. But if you are curious and want to read it, it's called The Feminine Macabre, A Woman's Journal of All Things Strange and Unusual. It was put together by Amanda Woomer, and I'll put a link in the show notes showing you where you can buy that if you want to buy it. If you're interested in the paranormal, I think it's a really cool grab bag of different topics from history and hauntings to paranormal investigations, etc. Really enjoying reading it so far. So with all that out of the way, let's talk about the Lent-Riker-Smith Homestead and Cemetery, right here in Queens, New York. Like I mentioned, this homestead is the oldest home in New York City that is still a home, and it was originally built in the 1600s. So I think that last week I said that this cemetery was in Astoria, but technically it's in a neighborhood called East Elmhurst, though also some places the neighborhood is called Jackson Heights. I actually used to live in Woodside, just south of the area where this home and cemetery is, like kind of on the other side of the Grand Central Expressway. And I never knew what to call the neighborhood I lived in either. My address said it was Woodside, but anyone in Queens would tell you that's not Woodside. That's not where Woodside is. I just had a weird fluke and I was in kind of a no man's land. And this cemetery is in a similar situation. It is close to Astoria. It's close to LaGuardia Airport. It's right by the bridge to Rikers Island. It really is kind of in the middle of nowhere, like so many cool places in Queens. And it's not that far from places like Astoria, but it's really in its own world. And I went there Sunday morning, and I biked there. I passed Lawrence Cemetery, which I talked about last week. It's right, they're right near each other up by the north shore of Astoria, or the northern shore of Western Queens. And it was very empty over there. And of course, part of that was because it was a Sunday morning, right? Like in New York City, no one's around on a Sunday morning. But just in general, there weren't a ton of businesses and that sort of thing over there. It was very suburban, very residential. Kind of the way I would describe that neighborhood is like, it's the kind of neighborhood where a lot of people have boats and jet skis on trailers in their driveway. Like, that's how I would describe that neighborhood. That maybe evokes a particular image in your mind, and if it does, that's probably the right image. I really liked it over there. It was really quiet. It is not even remotely close to the subway. I think the closest subway stop was about, 35 blocks away. That's why I had never been there before. It's sort of off on its own. And also, I just, on Saturday, got a brand new bicycle, and this was only my second time riding it, and as I was, tooling around that neighborhood, I saw that just everywhere, every part of the sidewalk, every part of the street was just covered in broken glass. And I've mentioned that in Queens, it's a lot of illegal dumping. I guess this sort of feeds into this category. There was a decent amount of trash just strewn around, but there was just broken glass everywhere. And I tried to avoid it as much as I could, but there were some stretches of the street and sidewalk where I was like, well, hopefully my tires survive, my brand new tires. And it seems that I have not punctured the tires of my new bike, and hopefully it stays that way, because I went on a ride again today, just in Astoria, and there was broken glass everywhere too. It's one of those things you don't really notice that much unless you're wearing sandals or riding a brand new bike, and then suddenly you realize there's broken glass everywhere. But so that's the kind of area where this cemetery is. A quiet, weird place right by the airport. So let's give this some context. I wanted to read a little bit from a 2006 New York Times article about the homestead. In a city virtually defined by real estate mania, it has had just a handful of owners. In a city where compact housing is the norm, it boasts a comfortable two-story house on a lavishly cultivated acre. In a borough known for sprawling cemeteries, it has a small one of its own. I really like that quote because it sort of shows what's so special and strange about this homestead here in New York City. And then I wanted to read a little bit from this really great piece on Forgotten New York about the house and cemetery, which really just paints a nice picture of what this area is like. It's almost maddeningly impossible to find. The closest subway is approximately 35 blocks away. It's surrounded on three sides by a high school, stockade fencing, and barbed wire. The nearest businesses are bail bonds joints. It's situated on one of Queens' oldest highways, most of which was demapped decades ago. It is arguably the most beautiful home in Queens, and one that has been rescued from total ruin by the passion and vision of one couple who gave the house a chance when no one else would. It was built in stages beginning in the mid-1600s and has undergone periods of ascendancy and ruin, passing through many families who kept it in various conditions of upkeep. It has had many names, but the one adopted by its owners is the Lent-Riker-Smith Homestead or Lent-Riker-Smith House. So before we talk about the homestead, you've probably noticed that Riker is in the name of this homestead, right? The Riker-Lent-Smith Homestead. And I mentioned, I think last week, how the Riker family was an important family in this part of Queens back in the day. And of course, Riker's Island is named after the family. So I've mentioned Riker's many times before, including in some detail, I think last week. But just a reminder, nowadays, Riker's Island houses a very bad jail, which is mostly made up of people who have not been convicted of a crime. It's right off the coast of Queens, but I believe Riker's Island is technically a part of the Bronx. And unfortunately, many of the people who are imprisoned in Riker's are from the Bronx, because in the Bronx, the court system is really backed up. So many people who end up suspected of crimes in the Bronx are often deprived of their right to a speedy trial. There have been cases of people waiting in Rikers for 5 years or more, just waiting for trial, just stuck there. And some of these people end up going to trial and then are acquitted, as in they're innocent and have been in jail for 5 years for nothing. And only 15% of the people who are in Rikers have been convicted of a crime. And those are just people serving short sentences. You know, of course, if you have a longer sentence, you would be sent to a prison. Rikers is just a jail. And when I say it's a jail, I really mean that it is 10 jails. There are 10 jails on the island. Supposedly, they can hold up to 15,000 prisoners. It's normally more like 10,000. But I was reading somewhere that I think in the 80s or 90s, I don't know, I didn't write this down. In the 80s or 90s, it often got up to more like 20,000. It's been called the world's largest penal colony, and it's a really bad place to be. If you want to help get high-risk people, like queer people, out of there, you can check out emergencyreleasefund.com, which is a bail fund, and that's just one way you can help people who are unjustly imprisoned. So when I went up to the Riker-Lent-Smith homestead, I looked at the map before leaving, but I'm one of those people, I have a really good sense of direction. Usually I just need to look at a map once and I know exactly where I need to go. And I was like, you know, it's right next to Riker's. There will be signs, I'm sure, showing you how to get to Riker's. There's signs everywhere all over this part of Queens saying like, here's how to get to the water. Here's how to get to the city. Here's how to get to a museum, etc. I didn't really think it through. Of course, I was biking around and I was like, man, I don't see any signs anywhere saying how to get to Rikers. And of course, I guess they don't really want to advertise how close Rikers is. It's definitely a stain on the city. And eventually I was riding around and I saw the bus, the Rikers Island bus. That's not what it's called. I think it's called like the Q100. It's the bus that goes to Rikers. And so I followed that for a while, but then got tired of waiting for it to stop everywhere. So I finally had to look at the map again. It is an easy place to get a little turned around, but the entrance to the Rikers Island Bridge is at Hazen Street and 19th Avenue, and the homestead is just basically catty corner to that. Interestingly, though I guess not surprisingly, the road that goes across the bridge to Rikers is very unassuming. I don't really know what I was expecting, but the area just feels like a lot of other quiet industrial areas in Queens. According to correctionshistory.org, which is a really great resource for more information about Rikers and its history and the history of correctional facilities in the area. The bridge is 5,500 feet long. It was built in 1966, and it has three lanes plus a 6-foot sidewalk. Before the bridge was built, people had to take a ferry to Rikers, and the bridge basically paid for itself very quickly because it saved a bunch of time and money getting people to the island. And also it made building things on the island much easier. It's much easier to just drive building materials across on a truck than it is to put it on a boat and take it back and forth. So just the money saved in building additional buildings on the island paid for the bridge very quickly, basically. And the construction of the bridge did spur additional development of Rikers Island for that reason. So in 1967, a woman's jail was built there, and there was a jail for adolescents that was built, and there was some sort of power plant addition that I saw listed in an article from the time. Like I've mentioned before, this is the area of power plants. Right before you get to the bridge to Rikers nowadays, there's an enormous billboard-sized sign that reminded me sort of the signs you might see outside roadside tourist attractions. It's this huge, well-maintained sign. It felt really incongruous. So if you've listened to the episodes about the Renwick Smallpox Hospital on what was once known as Blackwell's Island and is now Roosevelt Island, you might be thinking that some of this sounds a little familiar. You know, I talked about this on those episodes, and Rikers Island has some similarities to Blackwell's Island. So Rikers is named after a Dutch settler, Abraham Ryken, who took ownership of the island in 1664. As far as its pre-colonial history, I wasn't seeing a ton on the places I was looking at, but looking at nativeland.ca, it looks like the Matincock, the Lenape, and the Wappinger peoples lived in the general area. I'm not super sure about the island's history before Ryken came into the picture. Most of the histories I was reading of the island started there, though I am going to try to see if I can find some more information about the pre-colonial history of Rikers Island. So as you can probably guess, the Ryken family became the Rikers. I found some interesting information on correctionshistory.org about how some of the Rikers lived on the island in the 1840s, so I wanted to read a bit from that to give you a taste of what life was like for them back then. Living on the island necessitated having both a boat and tools to build or maintain a boat, and it required being able to make as well as repair ironware and tools. The farm, or at least Abraham's part of it, was an active one, in spite of his age. He raised hay, corn, and flax, and livestock, included at least one cow, though apparently not a horse. The household items are more surprising. 8 bedsteads and 12 mattresses together with 24 chairs suggest a large house or perhaps means of squeezing many people into a small house. 2 bird cages and a quantity of books suggest that all was not work. There's also an interesting anecdote that I read on correctionshistory.org that I wanted to share here. So to read from that, the remoteness of Rikers Island appears to have made it irresistible in the 1850s as a site for what the area newspapers called the disgusting spectacle of prize fights, which were seen as contrary to the public good, if not outrightly illegal. During the night of April 27, 1852, 3 chartered steamboats transported friends and others from Lower Manhattan to Rikers Island. The fight between Phil Clare and Englishman George Lease began after daybreak and lasted for 9 rounds and 21 minutes. It ended with the latter being knocked out and with a resulting riot. The next year, on the morning of March the 1st, a 15-minute bout between Adams and Connedy, attended by several hundred, resulted in Connedy's winning the $150 prize. It was noted that the authorities made no attempt to prevent or stop the fight. But the following day, Adams was caught and subsequently sentenced to 6 months in prison. The fight was arranged by one Robert Lees, about whom nothing further has been learned. So, you know, it's this island tucked out in the middle of nowhere, and I guess it was a great venue for some illegal prize fights. During the Civil War, the island was used by Union soldiers as a military training ground. And in 1884, the Rikers sold the island to the city for $180,000, which is $4.8 million in today's money. So for comparison, you might remember from previous episodes that the Blackwell family sold Blackwell's Island to the city in 1828 for $32,000, which is $885,000 in today's money. I don't totally know why the city paid so much more for Riker's Island, especially since Blackwell's Island is more conveniently located, being right in between Manhattan and Queens, and they were both being purchased for a similar purpose, warehousing people you don't want to have to think about. So that was a little weird, but interesting. I know I'm getting a little bit off track, but the idea behind purchasing Riker's, like I said, was not that different from the idea behind purchasing Blackwell's Island. Riker's was going to be the location of a workhouse. That was the initial idea. Then in the 1920s, the city got the idea of building a jail on Riker's, especially because the penitentiary on Welfare Island, which was what Blackwell's / Roosevelt Island was called in the 1920s, the jail on Welfare Island was awful. Conditions were horrendous, and the best option was just to close it, start over somewhere else. So you may remember from a previous episode when I mentioned this, in 1932, the jail on Riker's Island was opened. The city expanded the size of the island through landfill, so the island started off at 90 acres, and it ended up being 415 acres, so it basically quadrupled in size. And as the island got bigger, they built more and more jail facilities. So if you listened to my episode about Socrates Sculpture Park, or if you've read The Great Gatsby and remember about the Valley of Ashes, you know that Queens has a penchant for dumping garbage both legally and illegally. So in 1922, the city was banned from dumping garbage in the ocean. So they did what I guess was the next best thing, and they dumped garbage on Riker's Island instead. Which, while I guess it technically wasn't Queens or isn't Queens, it's close enough. At the time that the city was banned from throwing garbage in the ocean, Riker's Island already had 12 mountains of garbage that ranged from 40 to 130 feet tall. Eventually, the island ended up with 1.5 million cubic yards of additional garbage. And for comparison, that's more volume than the amount of dirt that was displaced from the World Trade Center's construction. I'm just going to read a particularly evocative bit of the Wikipedia page here. Since much of the garbage was composed of ash from coal heating and incinerators, there were frequent spontaneous phosphorescent fires, even in the wintertime, in the snow. One warden described it in 1934. At night, it is like a forest of Christmas trees, first one little light, then another, until the whole hillside is lit up with little fires. It was beautiful. The island was also plagued with rats, which at one point were so prevalent that after poison gas, poison bait, ferocious dogs, and pigs failed to control them, one New Yorker tried to organize a hunting party to kill them off. So, again, Riker's. Not a great place. It's been a bad place for a long time. In 1939, the World's Fair was held in Queens, actually right around the site of F. Scott Fitzgerald's Valley of Ashes. And in order to clean things up for the World's Fair, because, you know, Riker's Island is not far from that part of Queens, the garbage was finally packed up and moved off to Freshkill's landfill in Staten Island. Poor Staten Island. So they're the new place where people dump trash all the time. Oh, and another fun fact about Riker's is that the island is so close to the runway at LaGuardia that in the 1950s, a plane crashed on Riker's Island right after takeoff. So that's a bit of Riker's Island's history. It is an ugly history, but like I mentioned last week, many of us in Queens and New York City in general are hopeful that Riker's can be closed and that the terrible jails can be replaced with something better. As usual in New York City, it was at one point looked at as a possible place for, you guessed it, real estate developers to build some low-rise housing. But since the base of the island is landfill and toxic gas leaks out of it, that would be an issue. Also, there's the issue of it being really far away from mass transit, etc., etc. not exactly a desirable place to build some nice, fancy new housing. So there's a way better plan that many people support, including my current city council representative whose term ends this year, as well as by city council candidate Tiffany Caban, who the current representative for this area just endorsed this week, and who you can vote for on June 22nd if you live here in Astoria. Check out cabanforqueens.com for more info. But anyway, that plan, which I mentioned last week, is to build infrastructure to generate green energy, which would be good for everyone. It would create new jobs for people in the area. It would help address the crisis that we run into every summer here in New York, where we run out of electricity and there are rolling blackouts. This would be a great thing. And I'm really happy to see this issue in the news so much right now, and for people to be working to actively improve the situation with Rikers, which is very bad and has been very bad for a long time, as you can tell. So that's Rikers Island. Let's get back to the mainland, to the area right around the Riker-Lent-Smith Homestead, which I explored by bike this past weekend. So like I mentioned, the area around the homestead feels very suburban, although many of the houses are attached. And there are still a number of small apartment complexes, like a very pretty Tudor that's right across the street from the homestead. That was really nice to see. I have a real fondness for Tudors, and there are tons of Tudors here in Queens. So I always get very excited when I see one. So I've mentioned the Riker family in past episodes and a little bit already in this episode, but basically the Rikers were a very important Queens family. And in fact, one of the sources that I've used throughout this series on hidden Queens cemeteries is an 1852 book called The Annals of Newtown in Queens County, New York, which is actually written by a Riker, a James Riker. Looking through Riker's book, which includes the family histories of all of the important families in the area, there is a great drawing of the Riker's coat of arms, which I think is way cooler than the Lawrence's, which I talked about last week. It's an azure shield with three golden stars surrounding a white rose, and then there's this ornate filigree at the top and tumbling down the sides, and it's topped by a knight's helm, and then there are these horns with another white rose in the middle. Very cool. Apparently there was a later coat of arms from 1225 which had bears on it, though the book did not have a drawing of the bear coat of arms. The Rikers could date their history back to before the Crusades. There was a Hans von Riken, who was a knight, and he had a cousin named Melchior von Riken, and they were part of the First Crusade in 1096. They were part of a group of 800 Crusaders who were members of Walter the Penniless's army. I don't know who he is, but that is not a very promising name. The outcome of that crusade for the Rikers family was that Hans died, but Melchior lived. And the American Rikers descended from a branch in the family who lived in Amsterdam. Like many early colonizers in New York, they were Dutch. So I know I started this episode saying that I was going to be talking all about this home and cemetery, and I know I've now talked for half an hour and am just getting around to talk about the house and cemetery. So I actually decided, while in the middle of recording, that I'm gonna split this episode in half, and I'll publish the next episode, which goes into a lot of detail about the backstory behind this home and the really interesting woman who owns it now. I'll go into all of that detail next week, and then after next week's episode, I'll switch to the every other week publication schedule, because I don't want to make you guys wait 2 weeks for the rest of the story behind this really cool cemetery and home. So whether or not you live here in Queens or even in New York City, if you've been listening to this whole series about hidden Queens cemeteries, you definitely already know more about the area's history, as well as the families who different things in the neighborhood are named after, than probably what 99.9% of people in Queens know and in Astoria know. So that's a kind of a funny thing to think about. And I really hope you guys are enjoying hearing all these stories about the neighborhood and the area. And I just think it's so fun how it connects so much to American history and issues today. And I've been really enjoying doing this hidden cemetery series. And I still have a number of cemeteries to talk about. After this one, I'm going to talk about a cemetery that I used to live about 3 blocks away from, which is kind of a funny cemetery because last week's cemetery, the Lawrence Family Cemetery, as well as this week's cemetery, as you'll hear more about next week, both of those cemeteries include the graves of Revolutionary War heroes or, you know, soldiers who fought in the Revolutionary War, whereas I have plans to talk about another cemetery in the area that is supposedly full of Tories. So I guess the opposite of a Revolutionary War patriot. And I even found a delightful quote of Sheehan, the owner of Lawrence Family Cemetery, gently bad-mouthing this other cemetery I want to talk about in a couple weeks for being full of Tories. So I love some inter-cemetery drama and ribbing. So that's a little preview of some stuff you can look forward to. In the meantime, I will be posting pictures of these cemeteries on Instagram, so you can follow the show at Buried Secrets Podcast on Instagram to see those. I'll also include some pictures in the show notes at buriedsecretspodcast.com, which is also where you can see all the sources and everything for this episode. You can write to me at buriedsecretspodcast@gmail.com. If you enjoyed this episode, please tell your friends about it. Please rate and review on your podcatcher of choice, but especially Apple Podcasts if you listen there. And thanks so much for listening.